Thank you, Gina. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Luke chapter 2, where that baby's story is told for us. And we're going to take it from all the way today from the cradle to the crown. It's not in your notes, but if you would, just write this down, because it's the premise of that song, what we sang about, and why we're here today. The pain that you might right now be enduring, what you might be going through right now, may very well be the very purpose of your life. Christ came as a beautiful baby born in a manger, really a feeding trough, in a cave, a place made for animals. Place where lowly shepherds and servants might stay the night, but because there was no room for him in the inn, this is where he was birthed. And the world was introduced in the most humblest of places to the God-man. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch of their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone all around about them, and they were so very afraid. And then the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign unto you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." It's where the shepherds found him, but it's not where the magi found him. And there's lots of songs, and there's all kinds of traditions about Christmas that we follow. So many, too numerous to go into. Trees, and why we celebrate December 25th as his birthday. And boy, would I love to take the time today to just tell you about that in the 12 days of Christmas, the song, and how that was originated. It's hard to even find the origins of these things because there are so many myths and fables. There's so many stories, and some people, because of that, they don't celebrate Christmas. They don't celebrate birthdays. They don't celebrate any special days of the year. That's against their religion. But we celebrate his birth. Though the Bible never tells us to celebrate his birth, in fact, the Bible tells us to celebrate his death and his resurrection, but not his birth. But we celebrate his birth. We celebrate his annunciation, the day that he was proclaimed by the angel to the shepherds and to his mother. Even his conception, we celebrate, and the Bible tells us it's all right to celebrate. But about his birth, we're never told to celebrate his birth, yet we do because we're big into birthdays. From cradle till crown, he came. He came for you. His pain was his purpose. The entire purpose of his life was found in the pain that he came for you and me. Have you ever thought about that? Maybe if you're really going to be Christ-like, you need to find and discover that your pain, the reason why he is allowing you to go through this pain, whatever you're enduring, whether it be loneliness, financial loss, hurt, heartache, divorce, all the different things that we go through, possibly the large numbers of people joining the ranks of America and worldwide depression. Have you noticed that? People taking their lives. Another beautiful young lady, 35, 36 year old, a Detroit meteorologist this week, for no reason, wonderful husband, two beautiful children, depressed, took her life. No reason, just took her life. So many famed, rich, wealthy, worldly people, people that the world looks up to and calls them heroes, taking their lives. And then you flip in your Bible to 2 Timothy and you find where the Lord instructed Paul to write, men's heart failing them. We really don't know if that means literal heart attacks, strokes, physical afflictions or if it's referring to the fact for fear and of the future. People will just give up hope and they have no hope and they lose their lives, take their lives because they've lost heart. And maybe you're here today and you've lost hope and you're in heartache. There's good news from you. From cradle to crown, to the very grave, Christ, his death and atonement for our sins, his pain was his purpose. And for you and me, your pain may very well be your purpose. The greatest picture of grace was given the day Christ left the gates of glory and came to live and die for us here. In John 1, verse 14, John said it this way, "The Word was made flesh, and he dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father." And then we all know that verse in John chapter 3, verse 16. Say it with me. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but should have everlasting life." That is the hope. That is the hope of Christmas. But his pain became our gain. And the pain that you're enduring this Christmas season may very well give you the purpose and the mission for your life. So pay attention today. Todd and Tara Storch were parents that lived here in America, and they traveled with their family into the mountains of Colorado. And they wanted to go snow skiing. But a terrible accident happened with their 13-year-old girl named Taylor. And their lives were indelibly changed that day when on the slopes, Taylor took a wrong turn and went into a patch of trees. Their pain became many other people's gain that day. Two parents who thought to themselves, "This just doesn't make sense." But it all made sense to them the next day while in the hospital after the doctor had told them their daughter would in fact lose her life. Everything became crystal clear to them. They knew what decision they had to make. And then there's days like the world experienced back in the 1800s. And some people are probably poking the person next to them and say, "Tell them about it. You were there then." But in the early days of the 19th century, there's this man that we've studied him in high school and some of us in college. And it got very boring because we didn't really want and wish to learn about Napoleon. But as Napoleon's troops from France and the Allies there marched across Europe, the fear of Napoleon entered into your city or into your country, gripped the world. In Austria alone, one historian accounts that he took 3 million men's lives in just one battle. It was 20% of the male population of Austria. In one battle alone, Napoleon was making a name for himself. He was making a name for his country. He wanted his name to be etched with the greatest warriors the world has ever seen. And yet, we don't even refer to our dogs as Napoleon. In the same years that Napoleon was marching across Europe, there were six people that came into the world that have become world-renowned that we still talk about and dream and aspire to be like them. The first was William Gladstone of Liverpool, 4 times prime minister. He led Britain for over 60 years. And then there's poet Alfred Tennyson of Somersby, England, one of the world's most greatest poets. If you study literature and poetry, you'll for certain come across his name and great poems. Tennyson, the poet, Oliver Wendell Holmes of Cambridge, Massachusetts. This is not Junior, who of course went on to become a Supreme Court justice, but rather his father, who is a great doctor, lecturer, author, and a poet. He wrote some poems and he spoke at every one of his friends' death. at their funeral. And he was a man who wrote a poem that he wanted read at his own funeral by one of his friends. But some plagues hit, and all of his friends slowly began to die. There was no one to read the poem that this man wrote for himself to be read at his funeral, because he had no friends left. They had all died, but he was a great, great man. Frederick Chopin of Warsaw, Poland, one of the greatest, if not the greatest, composers of all time. Mendelssohn of Hamburg, Germany, the greatest violinist of all times. And then, of course, Abraham Lincoln of Kentucky, 11 times a loser in politics, but the 12th time was the best time. He claimed in his depression, in the loss of his son at an early age, and then the loss of his other son during the conflict in the States. He had lost so much that not only he had depression, but his wife had great depression. This man was consumed by a dark cloud that always hovered over his presidency. Many hated him. Many loved him. He thought and believed that God had, the supreme being, he many times referred to God, had divinely orchestrated his entire life and his pain of his life to guide America through the civil conflict. It's amazing what he did and what he overcame in his pain. Do you think it's possible that your pain can be overcome and that God could use your pain for his purpose? All of these six men were all born in the year 1809, the year that Napoleon went into Austria and wiped out 20% of Austria's male population. While he was obliterating Europe, his name is hardly remembered but in a history class. But all the other six names, we read about them, we play their songs, their music inspires us, and we are inspired by their stories, and we go to D.C. and we visit the monument named after that president and the pain that he endured, and we espouse him and inspire our lives after him. And he inspired his life after the pain and the suffering of the one that we've come to celebrate and worship today. Jesus the Christ. No one was paying attention to Bethlehem back in the year that time stood still, that tiny little hamlet where out of Bethlehem, even the Old Testament refers to it as a small, tiny village, that yet the Messiah would be birthed in and that he would come out of Bethlehem. No one was paying attention to a Bethlehem baby that morning where Mary gave birth in a feeding trough to her son. A baby does change everything. And you all know that because in your lives, when you had your child, and it does not matter the circumstances around your child, but when you had that child, all of the pain of 9 months, all of it, and I'm not just referring to you putting up with your husband, but all of the pain of that 9 months was all worth it when you held that baby boy or that baby girl. Maybe you had twins or triplets. Those babies, though, you didn't know where the money would come from and you had no idea how you would make it, yet the joy of that baby, a baby does change everything. Think of what you're willing to endure for your child or your children. God the Father gave his only begotten Son that whosoever believes in him should not perish but should have everlasting life. His pain, his purpose is clearly seen through the Christmas season. Educational systems, schools, colleges, and universities began because of this man. 2,000 years have passed, and think of all the different ways our world has changed. Even your life and my life today, if you belong to a men or a woman's group in town, more than likely it has Christian beginnings. Civic groups that we now can join in communities like Anniston and all the surrounding communities, they all originate out of Judeo-Christian ethics to do good things for other people, a Christian mooring, a foundational system that's built upon the Old and the New Testament. It's based upon Jesus the Christ, whose cross split time. His cradle changed everything. There's great societies that have been changed by the missionaries that he inspired. Think just 2-3 weeks ago, the one young man, 23, 24 years old, who went to that tiny island and lost his life trying to give gifts to the people who have never before had a missionary come and live among them. His whole hope, I know that many may say, He was unwise in what he did, but the whole hope of why he did it was so that that people group could be reached. If you think him to be stupid or unwise, think back to the Aka Indians, who Stephen Curtis Chapman has written songs about the Aka people, and how Jim Elliott and four other missionaries from New Tribes, they went and they flew in and started giving gifts to the Aka Indians. Unreached people group, murderers, people who were cannibalistic. And they delivered gifts, and then they started going and visiting them. And then there at the beach, the five missionaries were killed. And then we found out they had a rifle in their treehouse that they could have used to defend themselves and kill the Indians. But they gave their lives, and their pain became the purpose for their wives and their children. And now Miss Elliot went back and with her daughter and others won the entire village to Christ. See, it doesn't matter what that man gave 3 weeks ago in his life. You never know what other missionaries will be inspired to do by one life totally, completely devoted to Christ and given over to him. He didn't lose his life in vain. No, he gave willingly his life because he is a Christ-like person. Maybe your pain needs to become your purpose, and all that you're enduring right now needs to become your mission for life. Whole hospitals have been built because of Jesus Christ. We have Brookwood Baptist in downtown Birmingham. We have St. Vincent's Hospital that we've recently had people in our church in St. Vincent's. And heart, all kinds of things that the world is discovering because of Christian doctors, nurses, people who are devoted because Christ has inspired them. He did this. Feeding banks and the Baptist centers and all kinds of food banks all across our country, they were inspired by this baby who changed everything. Medical research centers today are making great advancements against cancer and other known ailments. I don't know if you've read anything on stem cell research and what's going on. It's crazy what's going on right now in the world because Christ has inspired us to advance the cause in every area of human life. Now, we know that sin destroys, but Christ gives hope, and Christ gives a chance. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. John 1:1-5. A baby does change everything. And maybe, just maybe, what you're enduring and going through should give you not the pain that you're enduring, but a passion and a purpose to keep on enduring and to press on and to press through so that God can use you in his mission. That baby born in a feeding trough in Bethlehem brought you and me the chance to have his grace. Grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. It didn't cost you or me anything, but it cost him everything. He did you and I a favor. He came and showed up and gives his grace. He shed his grace upon you and me, and all we need to do is open the free gift and pardon of salvation and say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart, change my life, inspire me, infuse me with your greatness, and Holy Spirit, use me as your vessel to run power through so that I may be a vessel of grace, a trophy of honor. Have you ever thought about what's happened as a result of God becoming man, becoming one of us, living among us, dying for us, and being raised up as a sign of what we will one day do? That is inspiring, to think about Christ coming, living, dying, and resurrecting so that you and I have grace for tomorrow and grace in today. The world has never been the same because of him. His compassion has made the world more compassionate. His healing touch has made the world much more humanitarian. His compassion upon the poor has made the world more empathetic to those who cannot help themselves. The most powerful man in the world has become the penalty for the sins of the world, and he bore the curse of the sins of this world so that he might save the world from the world's punishment of their own sins upon themselves. Now that in every essence is grace at work. If Christ had not come into our world, our lives would be hopeless. Without Christ, you are hopeless, but with Christ, there's hope. There's hope for your future. There's hope for your pain. There's hope for what you're enduring. And there's hope for tomorrow. There's hope that you can bank upon, and that hope is in Christ. His pain in your life may cause a purpose for you and me to endure. Christ came into the world and he split time. He made his mark, and we now mark time by his precious, holy name. He came into this world and it made the world a better place, a better world, and he will do the same for you if today you not only ask him into your heart, into your life, but you allow his light to shine in the dark spot that you're going through. Man, I could go, knowing you now a short while, I could go through every section of this church, and I could pull one of you out, one or more out, of what you've been going through and enduring. Hospital stays, the loss of your mate, your spouse, your son, your daughter. I could talk about how you've overcome memory problems, how your family's endured through Alzheimer's. I could talk about how you've endured the loss of your mother, your father, the loss of your limb. Much of our congregation has been touched by cancer. Almost everyone in this room has had someone lose someone by cancer. Then in one Sunday school class alone in the last year, we've lost 5 couples to divorce. One Sunday school class. That's the touch of Satan upon this world. It is the attack of the enemy. But with Christ, there is hope. Maybe what you are enduring is for a reason. And God's not only going to bring you through, but he's going to help you to get over. Remember the couple that I mentioned at the beginning of the service, Todd and Tara Storch? Took their family of 5 to Colorado. And as their oldest daughter, Taylor, was going down the hill, she took that wrong turn and went into a patch of trees. Hit a tree head on. They knew it was a major accident right that moment. And they stayed with her at the hospital. The doctors pronounced her brain dead. And then a doctor brought the mother and father into a private consulting room and asked them to do something that would be so difficult for parents to do, but so very difficult for a doctor to ask. He said, you know, Taylor is healthy in every way. Her body, her organs, but she's now passed. We've got her on a machine, and she's so young, I'm certain you've never been asked this question, but there are so many people in our world that are hoping and praying for someone like a Taylor who will donate their organs. Would you consider allowing Taylor to live on through her organs, her eyes, her parts of her body? Would you just, I'm going to leave you alone and I'll come back in a moment. They didn't need the doctor to leave them alone. They said, something good has got to come out of this horrible, horrific accident. So yes, we'd be willing. They signed papers. And the mother, right before she signed, Tara said to her husband, I don't want to meet everyone that she gives her parts to. But whoever gets her heart, I want to meet that person. So they asked the doctor if that was possible. And the doctor said they'd have to check. But if there was a match, they'd ask the person. So without going into all the details, the lady's name was Shirley. And after Shirley received Taylor's heart and was doing better, she agreed to meet Todd and Tara. And so the Storches went all the way and they met her and in her home, and they had one requirement when they came in. They wanted to listen to her heart. When they put the stethoscope up to the heart to hear it, Taylor's mother, Tara, said these words, "I don't know whose heart I'm listening to, your heart or the heart of my daughter." And just whose heart do you have in your heart? When you gave your life to Christ, you invited him into your heart. And he took all of your sins, all of my sins, and he washed them away. He gave us a new heart, the Bible says. Now, that doesn't mean you don't need a heart transplant if you got a bad heart. And it definitely doesn't mean as we age, your heart can't go bad. You don't have high blood pressure and all of that. But that thing's a motor. And that just keeps on running and running and running until it gives out. But listen, when you ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, he gives you a new heart, that the moment that your heart stops beating, he's given you a transplant. His heart remains. You still beat an eternal heartbeat. The door of death is the door to eternal life, according to John 3:16. Have you got your heart filled with the stains of sin? Or do you have his heart, a new heart, beating in yours? He'll give you a purpose to go through and overcome that pain that you're enduring. He'll give you a new passion for life, just like he did Saul, who became Paul. He'll change everything in your life, and you won't have to worry about it. He'll do the work if you allow him into your heart. He wants to give you a transplant, a new heart. When people will listen to your heart and see the works of your hand, they'll give praise to God the Father, because he's the one that loves so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but should have everlasting life. Wouldn't you like to give your heart to him and ask him to change you? Christian, wouldn't you like to dedicate or rededicate your heart to his work and have his handiwork in your life? Wouldn't you like to have passion and purpose where once your heart is just filled with pain, maybe your pain is for his purpose? God, I pray today that you would bring to this altar